going back to the complete system that we have discussed, in which we have not one building, but a collection of buildings, okay, that are connected to a district heating system that is using, that is supplying the heat to the buildings. And the equation that I have here is in fact defining the amount, and this is the term that is here, so the amount of heat that is needed for each of the distribution system that I have to supply. And what I'm going to do now is to look at the way and how I'm going to calculate the cost of supplying the heat. So the first thing that I will do is that I'm going to look at different technologies that can be used in order to supply the heat. I'm going to give, so it's for example the heat pump, okay? I'm going to calculate the heat pump in a given nominal condition. And then what I'm going to say is that I would like to know at each time of operation, I would like to know what is the level of usage of my heat pump. And I'm going to represent it by the value which is shown here, the FU here, the FU that is here, which is the level of use of a given technology that is supplying heat at a given temperature level of the distribution system, okay, at a given time. Okay, I'm assuming that it is going to, in nominal conditions, so when the level of use is equal to one, it has a nominal production. So this is the nominal heat supply of technology U if FU is equal to 1. Okay? And what I'm going to say is that I'm going to use this technology at a given level, and I have to add something, is the nominal heat supply of technology U in distribution system D. Okay? Calculating this value. The FU is the level of usage. And now I'm going to make the sum of all the contributions of all the heat pumps that I have in my very complex system that I have here. Okay, so I have a complex system that is supplying heat to the different temperature distribution systems. I'm going to make the sum, and I'm going to say that this sum has to be equal to the amount that is needed for the distribution system, which is coming from the sum of all the buildings. Right? So I have, therefore, solved the energy balance. This part here is just the fact that if I'm supplying heat at a high temperature, I can always use this heat at a lower temperature. So I'm making a heat cascade balance here, saying that the heat that is supplied at the level D can also be supplied by a higher temperature level if there is heat available there. Okay? Now, the way I'm going to calculate electricity consumption that is related, because I have to go, so now I have the level of usage, but I do not know what is the electricity consumption. I'm going to use the same formula as the one that I had before, so I'm going to use exactly what we have done now to calculate the amount of electricity that is needed by a given heat pump that is supplying a certain amount of heat to a given temperature level by calculating the COP, that is here, COP that is shown here, which is exactly the one that I have explained before. Okay, so now I will have I will know how much electricity will be consumed for any nominal conditions that is supplied by to the distribution system. Okay? As soon as I have this, then I can make the sum of all the units that are consuming electricity, so that I will be able to know what is the amount of electricity that I have to import, which is here. And something which is important is that at the same time, I'm going to write the amount of electricity that is, first needed by the buildings, and I'm going to add the amount of electricity that is produced by my PV panels, okay, and or by the cogeneration unit that I have here. So I can have also units that produce electricity and not only units that consume electricity. Okay, so I will make the balance on the electricity. And at the end, I will also look at the amount of resources that are used by the energy system, which is shown by, which is calculated by this equation here, in which I'm making the balance of the resources that I use. For example, the amount of natural gas that is used in the gas turbine that is related to the level of usage, which is what is shown here, of the level of usage here, of a given technology that is consuming a given resource. Okay? Which then allow me to calculate the operating cost of the system, where I'm going to say now, I have flows that have been calculated just now, I have electricity that needs to be bought or that can be exported, and as soon as I know the specific cost, so this one, and this one, of the resources or the electricity that we buy or the electricity that we export, then I will be able to calculate the total operating cost, provided that I'm doing the integral over 1 year of operation. And I will obtain Swiss franc per year. Okay? In reality, I'm not going to make the integral, but I'm going to make a sum. Okay? So it means that I will, instead of having a dt here, I will have a delta t. For example, each hour. Something which is then even becoming more than tricky is the following, is that in reality, I'm going to buy my energy system for 20 years. So I have to calculate 20 years of operation if I want to know what is the operating cost of my system. Okay? So it means that I have to make the integral over 20 years of the energy that is needed. And this is represented here, where you can, if I'm zooming here, so you have 20 years with variations with the winter period and the summer period. So the minimum value here corresponds to the hot water production, which is constant over the year. Okay, and the fact that there is some sort of a straight line is because we stop to heat. Okay, and in reality, this one here is in reality represented by something like this. So it's 8,760 hours. Okay. And my problem is that I'm not going to solve 8,760 hours times 20 years, for which I would have to calculate the flow. So it means calculate at which level I'm going to operate which kind of unit, because my problem will become much too big. So I have to find a trick in order to be more efficient in calculating the time steps that I have here. And the way to do it is by considering that in reality, if I'm looking at the outside temperature, I can have a distribution over time of the outside temperature. Therefore, I can consider that each time I have a given temperature, I will have the same level of usage of each of the units in the system. Because I will have the same amount of heat to be supplied. Okay? Therefore, what I'm going to do is that I'm going to consider that something which is important is to know the frequency during which I will see a certain condition. So how many hours will I see a temperature of 10 degrees C outside? Okay? And this can be obtained by plotting a curve, a temperature distribution curve, in which I will say, okay, this temperature here will have a certain distribution in time. Okay? And what is shown here is for this one, I know how many times when I'm looking at this point here. I should be more precise, okay? When I'm looking at this point here, is the number of seconds during which my system will see at least a given temperature. Okay? Which I will use in order to reduce the number of time steps that I will have to calculate. So now, yeah?
Over which time frame, the number of seconds?
So, the official time frame is the lifetime of your equipment. Okay? So what I'm doing now is that I'm going to calculate, because I have to estimate how much my system will cost in operation, I need to calculate what will be the number of seconds during which my system will be operated under some given conditions. Okay? And my goal will be to try to have the smallest possible number of conditions during to be evaluated. So what I can do then is either use this distribution curve and divide the distribution curve into steps. So for example, from this one to this one, and then next one and next one. Okay, so that I will cover the whole lifetime of the system with a limited number, because I will do it like this, okay? And I will have a limited number of temperatures for which I will have to calculate my demand, okay? I could also say, okay, let's try to represent the whole year by typical days, representing each month, okay? This would be one simpler way of representing the problem. I'm dividing by months, and for each month I'm calculating the mean temperature, and I'm going to say that all the days will be represented as a typical day in January. Okay, this would be one way of doing it. There are also other techniques, like the clustering techniques, which is going to say, okay, if I have a complete collection of temperatures, what I can try to do is to define a limited number of temperatures that will be named as being clusters. And for each of the cluster, I'm going to use a mean temperature that is going to represent the temperatures that are nearby. And this can be obtained by applying techniques from the data mining community, in which I'm going to associate one temperature to one cluster, and therefore I will have, by associating one temperature to one cluster, I will have the mean value of the cluster that is going to represent the cluster, and the number of elements in the cluster that will represent the frequency of the cluster. Okay, so this is solved. It's an optimization algorithm that is solved. It is going to allocate so tensors to clusters, so that at the end we will have a representation of the whole year with a limited number of clusters. And the consequence is shown here. So this is the basis of one study, complex systems with biomass conversion, with municipal waste, etc. If I would have calculated the 1 year without by just using 1 year, I would have had a number of equations that would exceed 1 million to be solved. Okay, 1 million value to be calculated, 1 million values. Okay, and the same system can be represented by using the types of techniques that I have just explained in clustering, can be represented by 7,000 instead. So I have divided by a factor 1,000 the size of the problem to be solved. And what we have shown is that it was possible that the error was less than 1% in the estimation of the operating cost. So it means that if you are smart and if you have to make the calculation of an energy system, it's important to define what are the typical operating conditions under which the energy system will be operated, to calculate for all these typical conditions what are the what is the frequency or the probability of appearance of a given state to be satisfied by the energy system in such a way that you do not have to calculate too many states. Because at the end you have to take decisions about those states, and there are still a lot of degrees of freedom there. Okay? So the consequence is that you have to find the best operating periods, and this is part of the your job of this afternoon, to identify the best way of representing the 20 years of operation during which you will use the energy system, okay, in such a way that you will minimize the number of calculations to be done, okay. The number of those periods of operation will be represented by a temperature outside and an irradiation, so the amount of energy that is coming from the sun, and a frequency, which is the number of time, so the number of time per year you will see these operating conditions. Okay? And I must admit that I have to add something to it, which is the extreme periods, because the extreme periods are the operating conditions that need to be satisfied, but that are not necessarily appearing a lot of time. So for example, the minus 10 degrees C outside is something which is not appearing frequently, but needs to be considered because you have to be sure that the building is still heated when the temperature is minus 10. Okay? So it means that what you will have to do with the operating period analysis will be to define what are the most frequent conditions under which the system will be operated, plus defining the extreme conditions that you are considering to be relevant to represent the operation that the system needs to satisfy. So I'm giving you the example of the minus 10 degrees C because I want to be sure that you are still having 21 and attending the lecture when the temperature is minus 10. But we could also declare sometimes that, and we have to be sure that there will be electricity available for safety issues. And therefore there will be one condition to be satisfied, that is perhaps not really frequent, but that in which the system needs to supply a certain amount of electricity. Okay, so those are the extreme periods that needs to be satisfied. Typically, those conditions will not influence directly the operating cost, so there are very low probability of appearance, but they will be used in order to define the sizes of the system. And as soon as you buy something for the peak, then you have the responsibility of using it over the rest of the year. Right? Do you have questions? If not, then this afternoon, what you will have to do is to solve the characterization of buildings, decide among yourself what will be the renovation options that you are going to apply to each of the buildings that you have to that you will consider, and you will have also to decide what is the typical operating conditions that the system needs to be satisfied to satisfy. Okay? And next week, what we are going to discuss is the next step, which is, up to now I have calculating the operating cost that I have just shown now. And of course, the next step will be to calculate the investment that is related to each of the units that we are going to produce, so that we will be able to solve the complete problem, which is minimizing the total cost of the system. Do you have questions? No? Then.
One short announcement for this afternoon. We meet again at 1:15. And it would be great if we met here first, all of us, because then we can discuss the questions that came up last time. And then we can split again in groups and go to both groups. Okay?